Janusz Bugajski from Center for European Policy Analysis, known as SEPA. Romania President Klaus Iohannis put a question mark just today on the opportunity of EU critics launched against Poland just a few weeks before an important NATO summit in Warsaw. Why do you think he did that?
I think he was trying to send a signal that despite the problems with the new government in terms of some of its changes in the constitutional court, some of the legislation, media, heads, etc., that Poland is a strong ally. It's a good ally in NATO. It's a good ally and a good partner for Romania. It's one of the countries that does spend over 2% of gross domestic product on defense. It is certainly abided by the values of the EU, and it was in fact the first country to break out of communism, if you look far back enough. Plus, I think he's also trying to send a signal that regardless of these problems, Poland is a robust democracy, and that the Polish public won't tolerate any kind of Putinization or authoritarianism in Poland. So I think it was a very good message. I think it was a strong message of a good friend for Poland.
So Romania needs Poland to be a strong ally in the region.
And vice versa. Both countries need each other.
Right. And in a few weeks, we will have an important, very important, historical NATO summit in Warsaw. Romania will pledge for a NATO fleet in the Black Sea. But I've heard other analysts being very skeptical that such a decision will be taken in Warsaw. What is your opinion?
Yeah, it depends what is meant by a Black Sea fleet. Remember, there are some serious limitations on the tonnage, the number of ships, and how long they can stay in the Black Sea as a result of the Montreux Convention. And Turkey, which really controls the Bosphorus Straits, the choke point into the Black Sea, isn't going to change the Montreux Convention. So we have to think of creative ways in which to increase the NATO presence or the NATO effectiveness in the region. And there are several things that can be done. I think this is going to be discussed at the summit. In other words, a permanent rotation of ships from different NATO countries, predominantly US, I would say, and UK, into the Black Sea, into Constanza, into Bulgarian ports. Secondly, I would say building up the navies of Bulgaria and Romania. Well, Turkey as well, but certainly Bulgaria and Romania. But that's expensive. And also to build up other forms of defense that could protect the ports of Constanza and Romania's economic zone in the Black Sea. In other words, better rocketry, better radar, better coordination with NATO. So there's a lot of things that can be done short of building a Black Sea fleet, which would take a lot of time.
You put something very interesting in this report, a very interesting one. You are writing here that Romania, as well as the other frontline states, should become an A2AD actor that can be a strong contributor to a counter-intervention capability regarding Russia's action in the Black Sea. Would you explain a little bit, Mr. Bugajski, what A2AD means?
Yeah, A2AD is this idea of area denial, which is something that the Russians have been pursuing. Since the occupation and annexation of Crimea, Russia has been militarizing the peninsula. It is creating increasingly these A2AD bubbles, in other words, to deny NATO access, port rights, refueling rights, any kind of or overflight rights in this region. And the danger is that as these areas are extended by Russia, whether from Crimea or whether it attempts something in Odessa closer to the Romanian coastline, it restricts not only Romanian, but it restricts general NATO access to the Black Sea. So the idea is for Romania and other countries to push back on this and to create their own space, area denial space or bubbles that prevents Russia from entering their area, whether economic area, territorial area, or area of strategic interest.
Yeah, but Romania do not have a fleet capabilities. You put also this in your report that we have a weak army, and we cannot do by our own this. We need a NATO support.
Of course, you need NATO support. Although Romania has now committed itself to 2% defense spending, but that should be seen as a minimum, not as the maximum, for the next, let's say, starting next year until 2022, I believe, for the next 5 years. But in addition to that, I think there needs to be a lot more done. There needs to be more modernization, needs to be more coordination with other countries. In other words, regional burden sharing. And here I think countries such as Poland can play a role, or even the Baltic states. But certainly America is going to be taking a lead role in this, if indeed this comes about. I think it's up to Romania to push for such a system. I think it's very good that the Romanians are raising this question at the summit. But it's a process. It's a long-term process.
Do you think Romania will receive some good decisions in this summit?
I think they'll receive some good decisions, not probably as far as they hoped. There'll be some good language. There'll be some commitments. You know, America is spending more on this reassurance initiative, the missile defense, of course, which I think all contributes to let's say, strengthen that partnership with the United States. It's never enough, let's put it that way. It's never enough, but it's a start. And I don't think that the NATO summit, we should see it in Warsaw as the end of the game. It's the beginning of the process.
All right. I don't see Western European countries like Germany, France, or Italy having the same interest like Romania or his strategic partner, United States, regarding relationships with Russia. While Romania, Ukraine, or Bulgaria fear Russia, Western countries seem to be ready to do business with Putin's Russia. What is your point?
Well, it's always the it's always the case when you're two borders away that you don't you have a buffer, and in a way, Central European countries such as Germany and Austria and Italy and so forth have a buffer, which are your countries, which is Romania, which is Poland, which are the Baltic states. I think the problem with the European Union is lack of unity. Secondly, as you said, business as usual. The idea that if somehow if you involve Russia in business, that you normalize Russia, that you may even democratize Russia. And thirdly, what I think Russia plays on is the idea and what Lenin used to call two steps forward, one step back. You go, you take territory, or you threaten to take even more territory, and then you step back and say, let's make a deal. And you keep what you've already got, and the other side is happy that you haven't taken more, which is, I think, what is happening in Ukraine at the moment.
It's Russian, typical Russian tactics.
It's typical Russian tactics. Nothing has changed. But the Europeans still fall for it, unfortunately. When I say the Europeans, particularly the West Europeans.
In the same SEPA report we have here, and by the way, you are one of the specialists involved in this working group. I saw your name put on this. Assess that Russian disinformation seek to erode public faith in democratic institutions by creating the impression that EU accession was a failure and that anti-corruption and reform initiatives are foreign interference. What Russia hopes to obtain in this disinformation warfare? Finally,
I think they're trying to discredit the European Union in order to weaken it, in order to renationalize it, because it's easier for them to deal with individual states than with the Union as a whole, to subvert it in some cases, to inject their business and energy and other forms of interest. And I think the aim here is to prevent a common front against Russian ambitions. In other words, if you can, as we've already spoken, if you can weaken countries such as Germany, France, and Italy to make a deal with you over the heads not only of Ukraine, which is outside of NATO, but what happens when you make a deal with these countries over the head of NATO members, such as Romania and Poland and Baltic states? This is where it becomes dangerous, but this is what the Russians aim for. I think ultimately also the EU is a threat to Russia, much more than NATO. Because if you look at EU rules, EU business practice, EU transparency.
Right. It's a democratic model.
Exactly. It's rule of law, it's transparency, it's fair competition, anti-monopoly, all the things that Russia is against.
Opposite to Russia, completely. Already Romania is a target of a sophisticated and well-funded Russia disinformation campaign through media channels, blogs, and cultural organization, as well as efforts of intelligence penetration to corrupt the Romania political system. Mm-hmm. You put this mm-hmm. in the report. And what would be the final goal?
The final goal in the case of Romania, I don't think Romania will ever be sucked into the Ruski Mir, the Russian world, as they think most of the Soviet Union can be. However, I think they want to neutralize Romania. In other words, Romania does not interfere in countries in which Russia has primary interests, like Moldova, like Ukraine. Romania does not have a close relationship with the United States, so the United States defends Romanian security interests. Romania does not oppose Russian policy on the international agenda. You know, this is what I call neutralization of Romania on the international arena. That is, I think, Russia's objective.
And you said also in the report, and this would be very interesting for to answer. Mm-hmm. As the second largest frontline NATO state and the largest and most important US ally in southeastern Europe, mm-hmm. neither Romania nor the Western Alliance can afford to see Romania fail. Mm-hmm. What should Romania do not to fail?
Well, I think it's doing a lot of the right things. It continues to have democratic elections. I think this government, everything I've seen and heard, is certainly making a huge effort to root out corruption, to improve governance, to strengthen the rule of law. On foreign policy side, I think the government has behaved in a very responsible way in asserting, NATO interests in this broader region. I would say in many respects the Romanian government has acted more effectively on the NATO front than some of its neighbors. If you look at a country like Hungary, or Slovakia, or some of the Visegrad states, I think Romania has acted more responsibly. I think all these things, in other words, not to slip back on the democratization front, on the rule of law, to fight corruption, to create a cleaner state. I mean, there's no state that's absolutely clean, but create a cleaner state and to attract investment, business, to make this into a more prosperous country, because all those things prevent Russian penetration. The Russians play on this idea that the European Union is a failure, that it's simply that there are two classes of citizens, the West Europeans and you, that it's a new empire, that they're exploiting you, that Romanian workers that travel to Spain and England and so on are exploited, that your country is sinking into poverty, the films they show on Russian television.
Right.
These are all the things they try and depict the European Union. So to be successful, you have to show them that this is nonsense, this is a lie.
And finally, Vladimir Putin has publicly threatened Romania after the Veselo anti-missile mm-hmm. shield was operational. Mm-hmm. Do you think that Moscow will take action, will do something in response, or is just a rhetoric game?
Words have meaning. Symbolically, I think it's extremely important because Russia is now telling Romania directly, you are in our sights, we could bomb you. You are one of our primary adversaries or enemies in this region. On the other hand, I wouldn't expect Russian missiles to fly because the cost, as they would estimate, would be too high, because that would absolutely necessitate some sort of NATO response. They prefer to do things bit by bit. They prefer to do it under the water, if possible, under the radar screen. So I don't expect, unless something goes crazy in Moscow, some power struggle or assassination of Putin or some coup d'etat, I don't expect any military action against Romania. However, I think it's to be taken seriously. If that is the case,
Moldavia, Transnistria, Baltic states.
They could, in the case of Transnistria, they could heat up the conflict again. They want to neutralize Moldova. They don't want Moldova to follow Romania into the European Union. So they play different political factions, both within Moldova and with separatist movements in Transnistria and Gagauzia. Mm. They play these movements against the government in Chisinau to prevent that government becoming like the Ukrainian government and saying, no, we want a close relationship with the EU. But I don't expect any direct military action. If there is a struggle, we expected this 2 years ago, that somehow the Transnistrian forces would link up with Putin's plan for Novorossiya, that, and from Crimea, that Russian forces would enter the Odessa region. It's still not off the table.
To come down a little bit with the border, and to come have down, a border directly with NATO and EU.
That's another possibility, and they could entice... It's a new book, actually, we've done. One of the scenarios I paint is how Russia could entice Romania to carve up Ukraine and potentially carve up Moldova. In other words, to play on somehow greater Romanian nationalism as well from the past. And I wouldn't put it past them. On the one hand, they may be against the country, but they will play with those nationalists in that country to gain advantages for themselves.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.